So first and foremost, everyone, welcome to this really wonderful program. We're very excited to be able to welcome to campus Emily Linden, and we're very fortunate to be able to host this program here this evening. There are a few familiar faces in the room, but for those of you whom I've not yet had the pleasure of meeting, my name is Chelsea Reed, and I am the Prevention Education Specialist at the University of Kentucky's Violence Intervention and Prevention Center. As I mentioned, our guest speaker this evening is Emily Linden, and she is the founder of the UNSLUT Project. She is the author of UNSLUT, a diary and a memoir, and she is the creator of the crowdfunded award-winning film, UNSLUT, a documentary. And that's the film that we're going to be viewing and discussing here this evening. So before I go over some of the logistics of the program this evening, I would be remiss if I did not first thank our wonderful coalition of campus partners who have made this invaluable opportunity possible. Thank you, UK Libraries, the College of Social Work, Office of LGBTQ Resources, and the Office of Institutional Diversity for bringing this program to fruition. Tonight's program is also supported by the VIP Center, hence me being here, and some of our other fantastic staff members. And it's also supported by the University of Kentucky Counseling Center. So if at any point in this evening you have questions about either resource or questions about services, please feel more than welcome to reach out to us, and we'll be happy to get you connected to either opportunity. Another thing I want to mention is that this evening we'll be viewing a really powerful film that deals with the cultural pervasiveness of sexual bullying and sexual harassment. We're also going to be exploring incidents of sexual assault and incidents of rape and the societal implications that manifest out of these acts of violence. And if some of that sounded kind of daunting, it's because those issues are daunting. These are big issues, and they can feel really overwhelming. So I empower each of you to feel well and safe and practicing good self-care. If at any point in time you need to step out, you are more than welcome to do so. I can promise you nobody here is going to think anything of it. If anything, we'll just assume you're getting a drink of water or going to the restroom. So before going into more detail about the program, I'd like to take a moment to share some information about the VIP Center. The Violence Intervention and Prevention Center here at UK is a confidential campus community resource serving those who have been impacted by sexual and gender-based violence through direct advocacy and resource network connectivity. We are home to the Green Dot Active Bystander Intervention Program, and the VIP Center is responsible for providing campus with prevention-based education training and programs. And we're working really hard to make UK a violence-free community that is truly a place of belonging for all. So now to focus on why we're all here this evening. Momentarily, we'll begin the film, followed by a thoughtful and respectful Q&A session, which Emily will lead. The UNSLUT Project was inspired by Emily's own experience of being labeled the school slut at age 11 and being sexually bullied throughout middle school. Now a Harvard graduate and recent PhD, Emily started the UNSLUT Project by blogging her diary entries from middle school. UNSLUT, a documentary film, is currently screening in settings like this one, theaters, and at festivals around North America. Emily has been featured speaking out against slut shaming on television and radio shows, including ABC, CNN, and NPR's Here and Now, and in many magazines and blogs, including Women's Health Magazine, Glamour UK, and Salon.com. I'd also like to mention that you'll be receiving an email after tonight's program seeking your input. We want to know kind of what your takeaways were, what you thought about this activity and about this event. Know that that feedback is really valuable, and it will inform future programming. So when you receive that email, if you could take just a moment to respond, it would be greatly appreciated. And now, finally, after all of that, and without further ado, Miss Emily Linden.
Thank you all for coming, and thanks, Chelsea. I'm really glad to share this film with you. As Chelsea mentioned, it's really personal because it's rooted in my own personal experiences. The film speaks for itself, and I don't want to say too much before I screen it and before We have a little bit of a Q&A following. I did want to get a sense, though, before we start, and because we have a couple of hours, I wanted to get a sense of where people in this room are tonight, what you're bringing with you here, and what you're feeling before we even start watching this film. So if you could humor me, I'm going to ask something of you. Just take a minute and think about the word slut. And think about a definition for it, if you can. So we have this word, slut. It's horrible for me to even say. Coming out of my mouth, it feels icky and wrong, and I'm not really sure why, so maybe one of you can provide an explanation. What is the definition that you feel comfortable providing? Does anyone want to raise their hand and provide one? Sure. Sexually promiscuous, great. Do we agree with this? Does anyone want to add anything, or are we good with sexually promiscuous? So sexually promiscuous man. That's a definition of slut. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We were all like good with sexually promiscuous, but there is some implication there, right? It's not a sexually promiscuous man. Is there a part, I mean, we all know there is. What's the other part of this definition? Does anyone want to add?
Woman.
Anything else particular? What's sexually promiscuous? You brought up the definition, so maybe, do you mind, what's promiscuous mean to you?
Frequency. A high level of frequency.
So a lot of sex. So I have sex probably 2 to 3 times a week with my husband. We're both really into it. Am I a slut?
No.
With multiple partners.
Cool. Okay, so are we cool with that? Multiple partners, frequency, multiple partners. It's funny, and I'm just playing a game with you now. You guys are being great. My grandmother, who must have been 86 when she died, I know that before she married my grandfather, she had like 10 or 11 different sexual partners, and her sisters used to give her so much crap for it, because back in the day, that was a lot, right? Like 10 or 11 was like, whoa. But then 60 years passed, and she never had sex with anyone besides my grandfather. She's still a slut, though, right? Like, you would point at my 86-year-old grandfather and grandmother and be like, that's a slut. No? Is there any other part to it? Anything I'm missing, then? Yeah. Other people can speak up as well. I know I've kind of put you two on the spot because you've so generously participated.
I mean, I will be happy to bring this mic to anyone in this room.
Yeah, definitely. It's used sometimes even really violently. The reason that I like to start, you know, intimate gatherings like this where I have a chance to see everyone and ask you to answer questions on kind of a personal level with the question of what does it mean to be a slut is because there really is no answer. There's kind of understandings we all have. It's a bad thing. It's an insult. It's something is gendered. It's a female thing. It means you're promiscuous, but promiscuity means different things to different people. And, you know, some people think, well, you've had sex outside of marriage. That makes you a slut. Some people think, well, you've had sex with someone of the same gender. That makes you a slut. Some people think you've had sex with 5 partners before, you know, you turned 30. That makes you a slut. There are all different definitions, and the problem is it turns out being a catch-all insult for women. Just a way to remind us that no matter what we've accomplished, what we've achieved, the life we've built for ourselves, at any moment, all of that can be washed away because of someone else's definition of what it means to be a slut and their accusation against us, that that is all we are. And I hope that one thing that this film demonstrates and that we can talk about a little afterward is how dangerous that word can be and why. One of the reasons I think it's because it's so limiting. It's impossible to be anything else once you're reduced to merely your sexuality. So I hope that you enjoy this film that I've made. It's just about 40 minutes long, and afterward we'll have time for questions. And I really do encourage you to think of questions as the film is going on. If there's anything you disagree with or want more information about, or anyone's story you're really interested in, please ask me afterward. I'm really looking forward to hearing your thoughts.
Always a little vulnerable for me to share that film with people because my story features so centrally in it, so I really appreciate you holding space for it and being here and having what I hope is a respectful and useful discussion. Right off the bat, did anyone have any reactions or something that they wanted to ask me about following it? So we asked about sexual bullying. I use that term in place of and a little bit interchangeably with sexual harassment, depending on the context. So bullying is like a hot button term for a lot of elementary and middle schools, whereas anything having to do with sex is not necessarily something that's easy to program. So calling something sexual bullying allows people who I think might otherwise not want to confront this issue, fit it into a framework that makes sense to them. Bullying, okay, we're in elementary school, we're anti-bullying. What is the sexual aspect of it? It kind of allows the people who are trying to fix the problem to have something to grasp onto, whereas I think sexual harassment just seems like something that's not necessarily a problem for younger students. But when it, as it manifests, it's often similar. In my case, it was being labeled a slut, and it involved some physical harassment, sexual assaults on behalf of girls in my class. It involved kind of being ostracized and losing friends, having people yell things in the hallways, things that look like typical bullying. But often when they happen to one girl in this way, when someone is targeted as a slut, it can be pervasive. Based on her entire identity in a way that other types of bullying aren't always necessarily. Does that answer your question? Good.
Yeah. So, to your 11 and 12 year old self, how would you have hoped for the adults to intervene on your behalf? What would that have looked like for you?
That's a great question. It's difficult to say. It was difficult to provide kind of a blanket solution for all middle schoolers or something that might work. In my case, I was an exceptionally lucky middle school student because I had motivated parents who were financially stable. I had teachers who were interested in my well-being, and I had guidance counselors who were on my high school's campus, and their only job was to make sure that we were well-adjusted and feeling comfortable. And a lot of high schools don't have those resources off the bat. So I was very lucky. And I'd say I got what I needed to the extent that I survived it. It was a completely unhappy and isolating time in my life. But my parents noticed, even if I wasn't able to confide in them, they noticed something was wrong with me. And they helped me focus on something I was good at instead. So one solution that I think is pretty applicable. It wasn't my life, and it could be in most people's, regardless of the resources you have access to, is identifying something that you really like to do or helping a young person in your life. Identify something they really like to do that they're good at, and then encouraging them to practice it and to spend time doing that activity. So for me, it was singing, and my parents did notice, wow, Emily has terrible self-esteem. We don't know the details of it, but she seems to feel happier when she's on stage performing. So they enrolled me in a choir that was outside of my campus environment, outside of that toxic social situation, and I was able to then redefine myself as not just a slut, like my classmates were trying to convince me I was, but actually someone who was a pretty good singer, and who people liked to sit and listen to when she performed on stage. And that was something to draw self-esteem from. And so I think that's what it comes down to, is allowing, I was allowed at that age, and I would hope another 11 or 12 year old girl, if we have them in our lives or if you're a concerned adult, that you would encourage them to build self-esteem by participating in activities that they can feel good about and then allow them to define themselves, because that's what it came down to, providing a new definition of yourself that you believe in. Anyone else have a question about the film? We'll recognize Mick Foley. Yeah, a couple nods. Are you a WWE?
Not the image. I wasn't a fan of it, but it came on television. That wasn't the image that he would have carried away from his wrestling career as I knew of it. It was supposed to be crazy.
Right. He was supposed to be. I'll use the villain. you're right. And in fact, I had a similar reaction when I realized he wanted to be involved. As you saw at the end of the film, it was completely crowdfunded. And if you've ever given to a Kickstarter campaign or anything about Kickstarter, if you don't meet your goal, you don't get any of your money. So when you're setting out to crowdfund, you better have a reasonable goal. And mine, for production as a first-time filmmaker, was $18,000, which seems like a lot of money to me. I was a graduate student at the time. It seemed like a lot of money to me. But I guess in the world of movies, it's pretty much a shoestring because we had to do another round of crowdfunding afterward. Anyway, we had $18,000 as our budget, and there were like 3 or 4 days to go, and we still had maybe $5,000 to raise. And as I said, if you don't reach your goal, you don't get any of the money, like zero. And so I was panicking, freaking out. I had already asked all my friends to chip in, $15 here and there, and we were really at our limit. And I got a phone call, and it was Mick Foley, and he said, "Hi, Emily. This is Mick Foley. You probably know who I am." And I didn't know who he was. So I was like, "Hi, I totally know who you are." And so I just Googled him really quick, I'm on the phone. And that video that I included in the documentary is what came up, him like jumping off a cage and slamming a chair on another wrestler. And I was like, "No, what? Who? And why are you calling me?" And apparently, he follows a porn star who goes by the porn name Siri, just Siri, on Twitter. Follows hundreds of thousands of people on Twitter. One of them happens to be a porn star named Siri. And she had given $250 to support Unsled, a documentary film, and had retweeted about it. And he, Mick Foley, happened to see this in his Twitter timeline and thought to himself that was something he wanted to get behind. So he called me and said, "I'll give $2,500 and then I'll match donations until you reach your goal." And so the last 150 of our donors are these diehard WWE wrestling fans who just do whatever Mick Foley suggests that they do. And I think that's really awesome because I was also surprised. I have stereotypes in my mind about what WWE wrestling fans are like and what they care about. And it was really heartening to me to see that there's apparently, in the Venn diagram of feminist issues and in wrestling fandom, there's a little bit of an overlap, and this film is in there. I think that's pretty cool. Is there anything else that surprised you guys about the film, or did it all seem pretty familiar from your own lives? Is there anything that you took issue with or wanted to address? Just in general, what would you do? What would you suggest in terms of a solution then, just in general?
I wish my daughters were here. I have 3 daughters, and I wish they were sitting here, but I've got granddaughters now, and I think, oh my gosh. But know. I mean, it's just, I mean, I read a lot of Twitter and all of that too. And I think people generally say the worst things on Twitter, and you know, because they know they're not being they don't, they're invisible. It's just really intense, and I can't imagine having to go through that myself.
I know. I agree. You know, I'm 31 now, and so when I was going through this type of bullying, I was as the late 90s into the early 2000s about, and mostly the late 90s, and we had AOL Instant Messenger. Do you guys remember that? Where it was a little image of a running man, AOL 2.0 or whatever, and that was the way I was cyberbullied. Someone made a screen name, Die Emily Linden, and messaged me from it, and I remember it. You know, this was 20 years ago now, and I still remember this visceral feeling of, we had one computer, and it was in the den in the middle of my family's house. We didn't have cell phones, imagine. We all just had to, if we wanted to access our email, we all had to wait and log in and dial up, all that. And it popped up on the screen, you know, why haven't you killed yourself yet? From this message, from the screening, Die Emily Linden. And I still, it felt like an invasion, you know, because before that, I had been able to just kind of leave that at school. As long as I could make it home, I was safe in this sanctuary. And you're absolutely right. Nowadays, people don't have that at this age. A lot of people already have cell phones, and even if they don't, their friends do, and even if they don't, they have access to the internet, and it doesn't stay contained. And it can feel, you know, one of the points that Mick Foley made that I think is really important is that lends to this feeling of permanence, that there's, if you're labeled, and you know, I should make clear, slut is not necessary in slut shaming. Like, this is, it doesn't have to include the word slut, right? And I mean, it could be whore, it could be thought, it could be any number of synonyms, but it also doesn't even have to involve a label. We're talking about the implication that girls and women should be ashamed of being the targets of sexual violence or of their sexuality generally. But with that said, you know, being labeled that way, you could define yourself in another way. You could kind of escape from that. But in Mateo's case, you know, by the time it got to 2013, even 5 years ago already, she had to move to 3 different schools, and it didn't solve her problem. There was no difference. The people already knew what her reputation was. So it does make it a lot more difficult. Yeah. That I think is really important when we have this tendency to be afraid. The internet, especially, you know, within the news now, is so overwhelming and terrifying, to me at least. It feels like I don't have a handle on everything that's possible in terms of how different tools of the internet can be used against us generally and me personally. I'm talking about everything from like national security to what's often unfortunately called revenge porn or images being shared without someone's consent. All of it can be really intimidating, and I'm really glad you made that point, because it is so important to remember that it can be, you know, the internet is a tool. All of these things are tools that can be used by humans, and we can choose to use them for good. And if enough of us choose that and really commit to it, then the culture changes. I mean, honestly, we all just have to kind of hold each other accountable to it, and it can feel very intimidating and overwhelming, but there are spaces like the Unslut Project where that can happen, where you can share your story online. And a lot of hashtag feminism has happened this way as well. A lot of my feminist activist colleagues will kind of be dismissive about hashtags, you know, people sharing stories on Twitter that way. But I find power in it because it matters that your voice is part of a chorus. I think the Me Too movement is called Me Too, not by accident, certainly, it was designed that way, but also because the solidarity is what matters. It's not just listening to someone's story. It's not just telling your own. It's finding someone else. It's finding each other. It's that connection. It's the hearing and the healing that happens in personal story sharing. And the internet does facilitate that if we let it and if we use it that way. I'm glad you made that point.
able to take it to like high schools or if high schools have been involved at all with it, as far as showing it to other kids and stuff.
Yeah, so we have. Most of my screenings have been in environments like this at universities, high schools as well around North America. We started screening it a little over, actually about 2.5 years ago now. We finished it, and yeah, it's been about 2.5 years where we've been traveling around and showing it at film festivals as well. And the reception really varies on the audience. So here we have like a mixed crowd. Often when we screen it at a film festival, it's part of a series of shorts that have all different topics. So you'll get people who, you know, unlike you, didn't really necessarily sign up for a dark discussion or a discussion that might be kind of rattling. And so in that case, it's actually really enlightening to see people's gut reaction to content they didn't expect that can be so unexpectedly relatable. And I find it, this film especially, it is available online. You mentioned that you wished your daughters were here and you'd like to share it with them. If there's anyone else that you guys would like to share this with, we're actually screening the film again tomorrow. And it's available online, so it's pretty easy to access and to share around. And I did that on purpose because it is a really good, it's a good film to screen in private. So as much as it's been received well and these conversations have gone well among, you know, in groups of people, often it can be a little bit scary to speak up and share something in this area with strangers in a room in a setting like this. I mean, we're all here and it can feel a little uncomfortable. So I do think that I encourage all of you to share this in private as well and have some one-on-one conversations because those can be just as important, if not more.
On the topic of comprehensive sexual education, would you suggest incorporating within a course like that's provided to students a section on terms and slut shaming and et cetera, like on that, like a different side of sexual education, or would you say it would be more beneficial to have a course by itself on terms like this and getting kids more aware of like what slut shaming actually is, how you can stop it, or how you can take preventive actions? Like, do you think it'd be beneficial with a comprehensive sexual education course, or like separate?
I've seen it mostly be implemented in conjunction with other types of content. So, for instance, if you're teaching people about consent, I mean, that would be part of a comprehensive sex education course, and slut shaming comes up as part of that conversation. I think that the concept of slut shaming in terms of, you know, preventing someone from speaking up about an assault that's already happened, or being used to justify an assault that's happened, being used in the realm of bullying to kind of divide or ostracize a person, it's so embedded in a lot of the topics that already come up when you're talking about sex education that I think it's easiest, and in terms of policy and what we can actually accomplish, most effective to incorporate it into programs that schools are already on board with. And often it just takes, you know, a really motivated teacher to kind of change the tone around some of the conversations to make it much more inclusive and to make it so that some of the students aren't being shamed out of participating in the discussion. You know, because what if you're in high school talking about, I remember my sex ed in high school, you know, we were told that if you had sex before marriage, you were worthless. A metaphor was, and some of you might have similar stories to this. My sex education teacher took a piece of scotch tape and stuck it to her sweater and peeled it off her sweater and then handed it to the first student in the first row who was instructed to stick it to his sweater and peel it off and hand it to the next person and so on. And by the end, she took this piece of scotch tape and attempted to stick it to the chalkboard and it just fell off. And she said, see, it's worthless. No, it won't nobody's gonna stick to this because it's already been stuck to everyone in this room. And the metaphor, the analogy she was making, I should say, is that if, you know, you were to have sexual intercourse with someone, you would lose part of yourself. You know, you're like that piece of tape that's losing part of what makes you useful and good to a potential partner who might want to stick to you. So if that's where we're starting, like that type of content in it, you know, to be fair, this was in the early 2000s, but it was a progressive public high school in Massachusetts, I would say. It wasn't so weird. we have a lot of work to do when it comes to comprehensive sex ed. And I think that kind of changing the tone that we take when we talk to kids about sex, treating them with respect, treating it as a topic that is incredibly important. Sex is important in almost everyone's life, and you know, deserving of respect and time, but not something that is you know, separate from the way we treat each other and the way we respect each other's opinions in our everyday lives. Anyway, you know, it applies to a lot of different aspects of sex education, I would say. Yeah. Do you have any programs here that you have in mind that are kind of that keep slut shaming separate or that you've seen work well?
I'm actually in grad school for health promotion,
okay.
And I specialize in sex education.
Awesome.
So I do research in the research lab there, and I'm just working on different research right now, thinking about different ideas of how to get people talking and more proactive. Also, there's a organization here called Lex Ed that's working on comprehensive sexual education for Fayette County. So just different ideas of that.
That's great.
Some people, some sections are very non-comprehensive, so maybe setting up something else for students who want to know about this.
At the college level, you're saying?
No, more like middle school.
Middle school.
Public school. We do have a sexual education program here at UK that's pretty comprehensive. So.
Right. I know, and often by the time it gets to the college level, there's already a lot of stuff that has to be unlearned, unfortunately, as you know. Thanks for doing that work. That's incredibly important. How long have you been doing that here?
I'm actually just a first year master's student, so not too long, but.
Great. Well, you're a great resource, I'm sure. Does anyone else have a question they'd like to ask? That's a great question. I would point it toward, well, accountability. Because we've gotten now, we're in this moment of story sharing. And when I made this film 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, that we first started screening it, it was radical and odd, this concept that someone would share their story, would speak about this, and say, it's happened to me. Just since October now, we've had this movement, as you mentioned, where we're trying to normalize the experience of coming out and saying, something has happened to me too. Sexual harassment, sexual assault, I've gone through too, you're not alone. So the story sharing is gaining momentum, and we're kind of open to hearing these stories and not immediately saying, no, she must have made it up, no, she must have been asking for it, she must have done something wrong. We're able to hear these stories without automatically having this knee-jerk reaction to dismissing them or blaming the victim, okay? But we're just kind of getting there, and so we have a lot more of work to do. And the next step, I would hope, and what I guess the next film might be about, is what happens then? Once you've told your story, once you've shared this, what do we do with that information? How do we change our culture so that it stops happening? And I do think the first step is to talk about it and to examine our own prejudices. And we're in the process of that now. And the next step is holding accountable, making sure that the behaviors that that we're trying to stop are behaviors that we recognize and hold people accountable for. And I think that's a little bit more uncomfortable to talk about because there is a stage of raising your hand and saying, this has happened to me. But then there is a stage of looking around and saying, so who did this to me? And I think that's where we are now, which is a reckoning. Yeah. On that note, did anyone have any questions about getting the crowdfunding together for this film or the movie making in general, aside from the content? Or anything that might be related to, let's see, we've got a while, so I was hoping that you guys would have some questions to grill me with. Yeah.
How hard was it to get people to talk to you?
No, it wasn't hard at all.
So
Samantha Gailey Geimer, the woman who was raped by Roman Polanski when she was in middle school, reached out to me. And when she told me who she was, I didn't believe it. I mean, I had just started this crowdfunding process for this film. It was just going to be about Rehtaeh Parsons and her life and her story, because that's what had really rattled me and moved me to start this project. Her family was ready to talk about it. They were excited and really wanted to tell her story, because they felt that that was what they had. You know, that was all they had of her left, and they wanted, if they couldn't have their daughter, they wanted to at least have her legacy serve, you know, to prevent it from happening to other people. So that was not difficult. And again, Samantha Gailey Geimer came to find me. All of these women, actually, Gina Tron, who shared a story about being raped in Brooklyn, she also sought me out to share a story, and she had written about it in Vice magazine. I would say it wasn't difficult at all. As I'm answering you, I'm realizing that's the truth. And I think it really is a, you know, part of it is that it felt like it's time. It feels like they're, if you've been holding a story like this in your heart for a really long time, and someone is giving you an opportunity to share it, sometimes it can feel like a relief. And I also just think a lot of these women were at a place where they had distance from what had happened to them. I really wanted to talk to someone who was currently being sexually bullied in high school, and to hear what it was like, and to maybe get them on film, talking us through the process that they overcame it. And though I have heard from so many young women privately about what that process is like, and you know, talk them through what they're going through, getting people to report that on camera, to put them at that age, to put yourself in front of a camera and say, "People think I'm a slut. I'm labeled a slut." It's still too stigmatized. There's still a barrier there. In fact, even in screenings like this, I've had, you know, women who are in their 50s and 60s stand up and say, I've never told anyone this. I haven't even told my husband, but something similar happened to me at the time. I think with something that has so much weight and stigma surrounding it, for someone who's going through it at the time, a middle school student, to, you know, open up and talk about it on film, would just be, it was just impossible. There was no way to talk someone into that, and I wouldn't have wanted to. You know, I really wanted them to feel comfortable being on camera and telling their story. So, yeah, it was easy. Adults, I feel like, if you've got some distance, it's really easy to kind of open up the floodgates, and it feels really good and cathartic to talk about it, but yeah, when it's closer to home and you're just going through it, it can be really sensitive. Is there anything else should touch upon? Yeah.
Do you know if Rehtaeh's parents, like their understanding of what happened and what she went through, do you think it's changed over time? Or like, do you know? Just because I think of like parents from like where I'm from, they would have no idea. Like, I mean, maybe now that it's all out on the media, but like back at the time when I was in middle school, I know my parents would have just been so unaware of like what kids that age.
Yeah. What happened with Rehtaeh is that when she was 15 when she was raped, and she didn't tell her parents about it after it happened. It was only the next day at school, when the boys told their friends kind of their version of the story, her mom heard about it anyway. And so then she was able to confide in her. And, you know, she was failed by a lot of people in her life, but I do think that her mom, Leah, was doing her best to be a good resource for Rehtaeh, and so her opinion of it hasn't really changed. You know, when she was reporting to me what happened, she just said, "This is what Rehtaeh, you know, told me happened that night," and it hasn't changed in the years, you know, since Rehtaeh first told her, and the way that she kind of thinks about it now. However, I do think Glenn's experience, her father Glenn, would actually have to move. He had to leave Nova Scotia and move to Toronto because he was being harassed, cyber harassed, for speaking out about this, and having his life threatened. And actually, after participating in this film, things got really bad for him as well, which is horrible, and was surprising to me. But at any rate, so for him, I know his opinion about Rehtaeh's death has been just clouded, and his opinion, sorry, about what happened to her that night and the trauma that she went through has been clouded by the events since her death, and the really horrible reaction that a lot of people have had to it.
Yeah. Just watching it, how Rehtaeh's family tried to like come together and, you know, reach out to other people about her story, and yet they still got like a negative reaction off of Facebook and things like that. I don't know, like, I'm sure a lot of people have heard like the Brock Turner story and how like even with him, like he got like a very minimum sentence and the judge was very much in his favor. Like, why do you think that even after a death that people still don't get what's going on or asking questions? Like, well, why did she choose to do this? Or why is it that there isn't more of this out there for me to talk about?
Some of you probably have the answers you're thinking of as well. My gut instinct and what I've learned just from talking to people who, you know, who have gone through something like this is that it's just, it's too much. In fact, sorry, I've lost my train of thought. Could you repeat the last part of that question? Because I had this long answer in my head and now I've lost my train of thought.
It's just like, I guess it baffles me that people look
like how.
Why do they still create this like train of hate, I guess, towards someone even after they take their life?
Like, why is it so hard for us to come to terms with it? I think that it has to do with what I mentioned earlier, the holding accountable. Because it's easy to kind of think of a rapist as a monster who like jumps out at you from the bushes. And as long as we don't actually talk to people who have been attacked or who have gone through, you know, everyday sexual harassment and what it looks like, you know, on the other end of the spectrum, or people who have gone through the worst of these, of what it really means to be sexually violated in some way. Once we know those details, once we listen to those stories, we have to reconcile the people who did that to them with this image of like a monster that we have in our minds. And I think that barrier of looking around at the people that are accused, the people that are in all of our lives, that we, you know, in some cases know and love and interact with daily, I mean, the accused have communities and have people who love them. I think that reckoning of this person I love is capable of something like this, of is capable of hurting another woman or is capable of hurting a person in this way, is too much. I think it's too much for people to wrap their heads around, and so the easier knee-jerk reaction is to fall back on the trope of dismissing women, assuming women make stuff up, we're all liars, we just want attention. It's easier to imagine, I think, a crazy lady in a fantasy world who wants attention than it is to reckon with the fact that an everyday dude on the street might have raped someone. I just think it's too scary of a concept for a lot of people to really let sink in. That's my gut. I think it's fear. Does that resonate with people? Do you want to add? Yeah.
Actually, I'm going to disagree with you.
Yeah, go ahead. What do you
think? I'm just going to tell you a Macbeth story.
I love it.
When I was young, because I was very soft-spoken, I was considered gay. The advantage for me was you had to face me physically in order to get my attention. But what I learned over the years is the most people who were the ones who were the most outspoken were quite often concerned about their own sexuality. So what I'm really feeling is that a lot of these people have this idea or have attempted it, and now they are protecting themselves.
That's a good point, yeah. And I don't think you do disagree with me. I agree with you. I agree with your point. I think that's another layer to it for a lot of people, especially homophobia, as you mentioned, and with all different types of sexuality, things that we feel uncomfortable and vulnerable about. Dr. Hernandez Chavez made this point at the end of the film, is to really look at ourselves if we have a judgment about someone, or if we have, you know, if we have the temptation to share a negative rumor, or to laugh at a nasty joke, or to believe something negative about another woman based on, you know, what she's dressed, or whatever this temptation is to participate in the slut-shaming, if we can take a step back and look at ourselves and where that's coming from, I think, one, that temptation kind of disappears, and we can also learn something about ourselves. You know, maybe some insecurity we have comes from somewhere, you know, important within ourselves, or maybe, you know, there's something we need to tackle in our own history. But it doesn't necessarily have, and it probably has nothing to do with the person that we might want to call a slut. You know, it has everything to do with our own. our own insecurities. And it goes the same for homophobic bullying as well. That's a really good point. Yeah.
In the making of the film, were you able to interview anyone that actually sexually assaulted someone? Have any of those conversations?
We did not interview any of the boys who had sexually assaulted Rattaya, or any of the stories that we featured in the film, we didn't speak to their assailants, not for lack of trying, but because it became pretty clear when we reached out that it was not going to be like a safe situation and it wasn't going to be a good conversation to have. They weren't going to add another layer to the story, rather. there was much to learn there. So with that said, I have spoken privately, not for this film, I've spoken privately with a lot, I'll say probably between like 10 and 20, probably closer to 10 to 15 people who admit that they've sexually assaulted someone. And it's rare, I say like so rare, and it's always in person. I don't think I've ever had anyone admit to me, over an email or something that could be traced back to them, let alone sit down in front of camera and describe that they've done this. I don't know, does that surprise you? Or it seems to me, yeah, I wasn't surprised by it either, because I feel that it's something even now when I'm talking about consent and where boundaries are with some of my guy friends. You know, I can tell they get a little bit, they don't want to talk about their own sexual experiences because of the risk of saying something wrong, or the risk of, yeah, being labeled a predator with a capital P and having no other space for a conversation.
So I'm a junior in high school, and I would say that certain school policies make it harder to add the disconnect of sexual assault that happens outside of school and then the traumatic causes of it that enter school, because of the fact that schools are not allowed to take outside problems and bring them inside unless they cause like a ruckus inside of schools. And certain school policies do hinder more slut shaming, I would say, like dress codes and things like that. So how would you say would be like a beneficial way to take that disconnect and maybe add like a bridge between both to help out like faculty and staff and students as well?
That's a great question. And I think that one of the main issues is that often it's discouraged. Like often having outside interactions with students is discouraged because of, I don't know, inappropriateness or a worry that there might be some type of lawsuit, I suppose, if teachers are interacting with students outside of class or online. But I have seen teachers within the bounds of their school's policies create Facebook pages so that even if the Facebook page for school is something separate, it still creates kind of a mental connection. Like I'm on Facebook and I do some schoolwork on Facebook, and I also kind of stalk some friends on Facebook, and I also like put some photos on Facebook, and using other social media tools that are much more popular now, able to interact with their students that way, I think makes it so that there's less of a divide. It's less like my school life and then my like at home on my phone life, and more of like my teacher cares about me no matter where I am, and if there's something that goes down online or when I'm home, he's always kind of in the realm of my team who I can depend on if I'm in trouble. That type of mindset, I think. So having the teachers have a way for kids to connect with them online, I think, usually helps, and making them available outside of class. Another thing that's really been useful is having ongoing conversations where people from the community, so like kids can attend with their parents if their parents are interested, or sometimes they're recorded and they can share with parents later, where there is kind of an honest, set discussion of questions that are going to be dealt with. There are resource officers in attendance and, counselors and people that might need to be on hand. And then there's like a straightforward, regular, low-stakes conversation that everyone knows is going to happen, once a quarter or something, about these really sensitive topics like sexual assault prevention in the school and the culture of sexual harassment prevention in the school. I think having a regular, low-stakes, kind of ongoing conversation with students and their parents and teachers and administrators has been one of the most helpful ways to not only let students know they're always going to be supported and they don't need to like call a special you know, assembly because one student's been bullied and everyone knows who it is. You know, it's kind of an ongoing, we're having this assembly anyway type thing. And everyone knows that it's okay to talk about it. Parents know they're talking about this in school. Teachers know, the parents understand what's going on. It helps break down that awkwardness. I won't say there isn't any awkwardness. There's always some barrier there, but I think it is possible and really heartening when adults kind of team up and realize that we need to get over that for the sake of kids who really need us to be their support team.
Are there any initiatives to help
in terms of like undoing gender norms, I really like Girls Inc. That's a great program. I don't know, many of you have probably heard of it or participated in it. They've got great programming, and I know they go into schools and build kind of self-esteem. And it's a feminist organization. You know, they have feminist ideals, and so they are in a lot of ways breaking down those rules. But have you heard of? It's called SSAIS, Stop Sexual Assault in Schools. And I'm an advisory member, and it's nonprofit, the only one that deals with sexual assault prevention in schools from K through 12. And the people who started it because their daughter was sexually assaulted on a school field trip. And because it was kind of similar, actually, to what you mentioned, but because it happened off school grounds or because it was on a field trip, there was like a scramble for whose responsibility was it and where is it supposed to go to the police or was it the principal's responsibility? And what ended up happening was just nobody did anything and it didn't get taken care of, and their daughter ended up having to leave school. And a big problem was that all the adults involved didn't really want to admit that something like that could have happened, you know, in middle school. And so, that programming and the education from the earliest age in an age-appropriate way, just kind of normalizing topics that don't have to be scary and uncomfortable, I think can lead to a lot of, you know, can undo a lot of the damage, and it can also avoid a lot of miscommunications later on. I would suggest checking out Stop Sexual Assault in Schools. I think the website is just ssais.org, and they've got a ton of resources and links to programming and also, you know, little videos that are easily to share, that type of thing. And I think social media presence too. Did anyone else have a question they want to ask?
Did you run into any male victims while you were doing your on the journey?
Yes, and I'm glad you asked that. Often these conversations are kind of framed or pitted women against men, and it's one of the things that's been most important to me with this movement is that people of all genders feel comfortable speaking up about what they've gone through and listening to each other. I have heard from a lot of male victims of sexual assault, and there's a whole other layer of shame there that's tied into a toxic idea of masculinity, I think. You know, it's the kind of a shame about being a victim when you ought to be kind of the violent aggressor. You know, being on the other end of that is thought of as a different iteration of shameful than women victims often experience. And so there's also a whole other layer of silence. And I feel, some of the best conversations I've had have been when male victims finally feel that they're able to talk about it. I don't know if you noticed, but at the end of the film, I was wearing a shirt that says "Define Slut." It's because that's one of my favorite ways to start conversations. When I witness someone slut shaming, I'll just ask, like, "What does that mean? Huh? What do you mean by that?" Kind of the way that we did at the beginning of tonight, and continue asking questions until the word kind of falls apart. And those t-shirts, you start a lot of conversations. So one time I was at a film screening at a film festival, I think in Vermont, and a man came up to me and was like, "Oh, haha, define slut. I know what that is," or, you know, made some joke about it. And I said, "What? What is it?" And I'm not sure how he answered, but by the end of, you know, 5 to 6 minutes of just that conversation with a stranger at a film festival based on a t-shirt, we were holding each other, he was in tears, and he was admitting that he had this, I shouldn't even use the word admitting, it implies he did something wrong. He was finally letting go and saying out loud that he had held on to for years, that he had felt the sexual shame about being sexually abused as a child. And that was mind-blowing to me, because like, I don't have any magical powers. I'm not, you know, a pastor or you know, a clairvoyant or anyone who can drag meaningful, traumatic stories out of people. I just think people are ready to talk about this when you say, me too. I hear you. I've gone through something. I'm an open heart. I'm an open mind. When you are a listener, when you let someone know you're there to support them, and when you commit to doing that, people will open up and will share themselves with you. And that's really, really meaningful. And that is the first step. And I really hope that you guys will leave tonight and be interested in continuing this movement and talking about these things with the people in your lives, and that you'll continue to start conversations, share this film if you feel moved to. I also encourage you to find me on Twitter and Instagram, just reach out, and really easy to get in touch with if you need a link to anything, if you've got any questions, or if you wanted to share your story or collaborate in any way. I'm really easy to get in touch with online, and I hope that you will. I hope that you'll all kind of want to be part of this movement and this change that we're making. I'm seeing progress, and I think it's really exciting. It's a cool time. So thank you all.